Dr. Morgan informed me that this particular class period is sandwiched between the subjects of the 1888 Minneapolis General Conference session and the Black Southern work. So I thought, why don't I treat on 1888 and black people? So let's go to the year 1888, Minneapolis, Minnesota, to a General Conference session held from October 17 to November 4, just under 3 weeks, in a recently built Adventist church where the meetings were held. And let's take a very focused look at this most important conference. These 3 weeks contain the most controversial General Conference session in Seventh-day Adventist history, and, according to many present, a turning point in the story of the movement. Adventist authors and historians agree on the importance of Minneapolis, seeing that more Adventist publications treat on 1888 than any other year, save 1844. And the legacy of Minneapolis is the source of fierce and prolonged debate. It was a conference marked by divisions along age, regional, and doctrinal lines. And Minneapolis is still as much a source of division as it was almost 125 years ago when it was happening in real time. Indeed, 1888, Minneapolis, and Righteousness by Faith have been resuscitated in modern Adventism, and the starting point for modern Adventism for our purposes here is around 1950. Minneapolis, Righteousness by Faith, 1888, serve as a kind of archetypal code word for opposing factions in Adventism, with animosity for each other reflective of the original participants. The original dominant participants are SDA legends. On one side, we have the old guard from the East, George Butler, who was 54, and Uriah Smith, 56. And opposite, the young upstarts from California, Alonzo Trevier Jones, age 38, and Ellett J. Wagner, 33. Also influential in the session debates were Robert M. Kilgore and J.H. Morrison, but history has discarded them to obscurity. And of course, perhaps the most influential was a 60-year-old Ellen G. White, soon to be the focal point of this presentation. I am going to wisely sidestep the incendiary debates during the session over the 10 horns of Daniel 7 and the law in Galatians 3:24 and focus solely on the most enduring component of the conference, the message of Jesus Christ, delivered by the young Californians Jones and Wagner, now known popularly as Righteous by Faith or Christ Our Righteousness. Frustratingly, especially for a historian, is the fact that no transcript exists of the actual message that Jones and Wagner delivered at the 1888 session. The only reports that exist are the notes that William C. White, Ellen White's son, took, the journal of one R. Dewitt Hotel, and recently discovered newspaper reports. And of course, there are the statements of Ellen White on the Jones-Wagner message, statements which have impressed Adventist descendants of its vital importance. The most famous comes from pamphlet 154, 1896, and I quote, "The Lord in his great mercy sent a most precious message to his people through elders Wagner and Jones. This message was to bring more prominently before the world the uplifted Savior, the sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. It presented justification through faith in the surety. It invited the people to receive the righteousness of Christ, which is made manifest in obedience to all the commandments of God. Many had lost sight of Jesus. They needed to have their eyes directed to the divine person, his merits, and his changeless love for the human family. All power is given into his hands, that he may dispense rich gifts unto men, imparting the priceless gift of his own righteousness to the helpless human agent. This is the message that God commanded to be given to the world. It is the third angel's message, which is to be proclaimed with a loud voice and attended with the outpouring of his spirit in a large measure. Ellen White would state in other places that Jones and Wagner conveyed, quote, precious truths that I could respond to with all my heart. For had not these great and glorious truths, the righteousness of Christ and the entire sacrifice made in behalf of man been imprinted indelibly on my mind by the Spirit of God? Has not this subject been presented in the testimonies again and again? When the Lord had given to my brethren the burden to proclaim this message, I felt inexpressibly grateful to God, for I knew it was the message for this time. Through the two young men, quote unquote, bread came down from heaven. Precious rays of heaven's light, and those at the conference seemed to breathe the very atmosphere of heaven. God had made Jones and Wagner his messengers, delivering to them the proclamation of Christ, our righteousness, and the matchless charms of Christ, and the rejection of this message via Jones and Wagner, quote, was the rejection of Christ and his message. Although the subject of considerable debate in modern Adventism, Ellen White did state repeatedly that Christ and his righteousness was rejected at the 1888 Minneapolis General Conference session. For her part, the co-founder of the SDA movement was traumatized by the proceedings and what she termed the spirit of Minneapolis. She reports fainting under agony over the rejection, lying ill in bed for 2 weeks, depressed and having no desire to continue living. She had no desire to continue living because of the way the 1888 conference proceeded. I encourage you to read for yourself the Ellen G. White 1888 materials available online at whiteestate.org. But, and I can't point this out strongly enough, Ellen White herself was transformed by the message of Christ our righteousness at the 1888 session. The area of Ellen White's growth or maturation is one that Adventists have had a tremendously tough time accepting, because the reasoning goes, if she grew, if she matured, please pay attention. In what ways was she ungrown, if you will, or immature before? Is that reflected in her writings? If so, are there portions or years that we should not uphold as inspired or up to par with those that later embraced her maturity? But White's focus, I should say sustained focus, and constant theme after 1888, post-1888, was Jesus Christ. Christ and his righteousness. Christ and his matchless charms. Christ, Christ, Christ. I want you to simply observe the books that Ellen White published after Minneapolis. What are some of the books that Ellen White published after 1888? Please, talk to me. What are some of the books that Ellen White published after 1888? Okay, someone said Steps to Christ. In 1892, Ellen White published Steps to Christ, a volume on how to have a relationship, a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. In 1896, she published Thoughts from the Mount of Blessings on the teachings of Christ in Matthew 5 and 6. In 1898, she published The Desire of Ages on the earthly life of Jesus. 1900 saw the production of Christ's Object Lessons, which treats on the parables of Jesus. And in 1905, The Ministry of Healing, largely concerned with Christ's ministry while on earth. If this is not evidence enough of a new, or at least a potently renewed focus on Christ, then one need only examine her myriad statements on her increased Christocentrism after the conference. During and after 1888, several developments transpired that I want to highlight before we talk about African Americans. First, Minneapolis marked a denominational renaissance in terms of youthful leadership. Ole Olson replaced George Butler as president of the General Conference at the Minneapolis session. Olson hailed from Christiania, Norway, and was the first GC president to be elected born outside of the United States. Olson was 43 at the time of his appointment, and I will make a case shortly for him being a very underrated pioneer. But for now, let me say that Olson was a Jones-Wagner sympathizer and embraced their message of Christ our righteousness. Neither Uriah Smith nor George Butler were voted to the General Conference Committee again after 1888. Moreover, in 1897, A.T. Jones unseated Uriah Smith in the coveted editorship of the Advent Review until 1901. Indeed, for a decade and a half, Jones was the most powerful and influential Adventist, arguably rivaling even Ellen White, casting a kind of charismatic spell over the denomination. Most notably, though, from 1888 to 1894, variously through the preaching and writing of White, but primarily Jones and Wagner's replacement. Who do you think Wagner's replacement was? Ellett Wagner kind of faded off the scene a little bit after 1880. Who was his replacement? Can you tell me? Wagner's replacement in the proclamation of Christ our righteousness. Do you know? His name starts with a W. Anybody? W? Yeah.
The guy that went to Australia.
W.W.
Prescott.
W.W. Prescott. Prescott replaced Wagner, as it were. And through the preaching of Jones and Wagner, there ensued a revival unrivaled in the history of the denomination. And it has been favorably compared to the religious upheavals of 1844. The Minneapolis message of righteousness by faith became engulfed in a kind of eschatological grandeur. Jones, Prescott, and even White purporting that the revival marked the onset of the fabled loud cry.
Amen.
The revival featured participants donating personal belongings worth almost $2 million and scores of hundreds of real estate plots to the denomination. Can you imagine a preacher preaching and people come up casting their real estate claims for the appeal? People were taking off their jewelry and throwing it. $2 million worth of jewelry and real estate plots. This is the sort of revival that was happening through the preaching of Jones and Prescott. But other more complex sequelae emerged from Minneapolis. Division still deep. GC President Olson, perhaps in an effort to ensure against further rifts in the denomination over the inflammatory 1888, watch this, diffused the situation by scattering their participants across the globe. Where did Ellen White go? Ellen White went to Australia. Thank you. Uriah Smith went to Europe and the Middle East. Ellett Wagner went to England. Prescott to international touring, including 10 months in Australia. While George Butler was retired in Florida, and Alonzo Jones represented Adventism before the political assemblies of Washington, D.C. Everyone in 1888 was defeated, was dispersed. Indeed, in 1891, Ellen White was sent against her better judgment to Australia, thousands of miles away to the Adventist frontier land. 1888 marked a noticeable cooling of respect for Ellen White and her prophetic gift. She herself penned that, quote, "My testimony was ignored, and never in my life experience was I treated as I was at the 1888 conference? White's post-88 speaking tours with Jones and Wagner, an outspoken emphasis on righteous by faith instead of law, further stoked the Adventist old guard's disenchantment with their previously esteemed prophetess. 1888 was the onset of what Albert Victor Olson calls 13 crisis years, because of the conflicting attitudes toward the spirit of prophecy, the Sunday laws being passed, the SDAs jailed and placed in chain gangs for their flouting of the blue laws, organizational dilemmas, and doctrinal schisms. I am a historian of black Adventism. However, in 1888 marks a watershed for the church's relation to African Americans. African Americans, blacks, what do blacks have to do with 1888? Have you ever heard people, anybody link blacks in 1888?
No.
What black people in 1888, what's the connection? Essentially, every participant in the White's, Jones, Wagner, Olson contingent was a strong advocate for the evangelization of American blacks. Their ascendance to denominational power was the beginning of the end of the period from the conclusion of the Civil War, from 1863 to 1866, to 1888, for the denomination's outright ignoring of the millions of African Americans in the then predominantly, who were then predominantly in the southern region. I will selectively look at Jones, Olson, and Ellen White, and how 1888 affected their attitude to black people. Let's move on here. First, we're looking at A.T. Jones. And here you see a picture of A.T. Jones and Ellen Wagner. And you may recognize some of the other gentlemen and the ladies, although I don't recognize any of the ladies. A.T. Jones. A.T. Jones really made his denominational debut, as it were, in 1888. For from then on, he was an Adventist celebrity of the highest sort, arguably the most powerful and dominant until the late 1890s. But at the 1887 General Conference session, his presentation on the color line debate anticipated his subsequent dominance. Dead set, Jones was dead set against any sort of segregation or race distinction on the basis of biblical and Christological principles. Jones and Wagner soundly defeated those pushing for color line recognition and Adventist evangelistic efforts and public meetings. Wagner put forth the following resolution, and this is important because you'll discover that when the Adventists were discussing after the Civil War as to how best to evangelize the 3 million plus African Americans in the Southland, one of the key questions was, should we recognize the color line, or that is the segregation that was going on at the time? This is what Wagner put forth at the 1887 General Conference. Quote, "Whereas the Bible says that there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, but that all are one in Christ Jesus. Therefore, resolved that it is the decided opinion of this conference that when the colored people of the South accept the third angel's message, they should be received into the church on an equality with the white members." No distinction whatever being made between the two races in church relations. In a curious sequence, the amendment was carried, but later it was ultimately resolved that, quote, "as the question pertains to the best methods to be pursued in the presentation of the truth in the South, where persons of African descent are most numerous, and as no one of the committee has had any personal experience in that work, we have deemed it proper to confer with those whose fields of labor have been in that section of the country. As the result of these interviews, we find those who are present who have labored in the South unanimous in the opinion that it is easy to pursue a course which will create no disturbance and do no injustice to the colored people. This being the case, your committee can see no occasion for this conference to legislate on the subject and would therefore recommend that no action be taken and that all reference to this question be omitted from the minutes. This is one of the key issues when it comes to black missiology, and of course, missiology is missions, evangelism. Should you go by the biblical principle that states all are one in Jesus, and we are all equal, rich and poor alike, or should you recognize the color line, segregation, discrimination, inequality, in order to reach more people? In fact, James S. White, Ellen White's son, would have his life threatened, as well as the lives of his evangelistic team, because they were even perceived as not respecting the color line adequately. Apparently, the inexperience of the Jones, Wagner, and the other amenders was seen as too much of a detrimental inadequacy from the passage resolution, and it was overturned almost a week later. The record states that the updated resolution called for some discussion, probably from the outspoken duo, but the report was finally adopted. This was most likely what Ellen White referred to in her Our Duty to the Colored People speech, to be touched on later, when she stated her disapproval over the resolutions passing the color line. Although she cited 1889, she probably meant 1887. No such color lines resolutions are on record in the 1889 minutes. This casts 1888 in a slightly different hue. White was simpatico with Jones and Wagner not only on Christology and soteriology, but also on the divisive and polarizing debate over the color line, and also the 1889 General Conference, in which White could have derived some of her thunder and positions on race relations from the youthful tandem. Jones had begun his successful stint as a religious rights activist and advocate, and first visited Washington, D.C. that year. There he solidified his critical and durable friendship with Louis Schieff, the partnership already containing elements of pariah solidarity. Jones spoke at Schieff's church and was very pleased that there was no segregation among the congregation, which was half black and half white. Writing at length about the brewing Washington Avenue's racial situation, which was soon to take on magnificent proportions, Jones was always an unapologetic proponent of racial equality, even, it seems, beyond that, to the point of a total disregard and unconsciousness for race. And his words concerning blacks are free of the patronizing tone of so much writing of even the whites that supported black rights in that period. Later, when the Seventh-day Adventist Church disfellowshipped Jones, he found a harbor in similarly marginalized black congregations, most prominently Schieff's People Church. Jones' vast literary corpus reveals his solidarity with blacks further, this time as a Seventh-day Adventist who located himself on the receiving end of the United States' failure to uphold constitutional rights, just as African Americans had been in the past and were at the present. Jones's dozens of pages on blacks and consistent attention to their plight are second in sheer quantity in reproduced or original writing only to Ellen and Edson White. But in secular and litigious value, they have no equal in the denomination. A.T. Jones was one early Adventist who deliberately grappled with the meaning of history and the purpose of doing history. Rather circuitously, he agreed with Ellen White that history is essentially, quote, the study of the grand purposes of God with men and nations, shucking the popular Eurocentric notion of his age that blacks had no history. Jones pens or cites more than 100 pages of detailed history on selected ancient African civilizations, among them Ethiopia, Nubia, Egypt, Numidia, and Mauritania, which he alternately portrays as highly civilized, historically vital, and great. Placing Africa at center stage in the most momentous of histories, Jones is nevertheless steady-handed in his location of African societies with all the rest in revealing the providences of divinity as predicted in the Bible, alternately both negative and positive. Continually defined Africans providentially compelling in the United States, Jones, a thorough ideologue if ever there was one, converted his considerable knowledge of the black civil rights crisis in the United States to his Senate legislative career, extending the early Adventist position of America as eschatological villain for their mistreatment of blacks via abrogation of the Constitution. Quote, "Liberty is more than a political question. To discuss the advisability of granting or withholding liberty from any people is to question the advisability of maintaining or repudiating the Declaration of Independence and the National Constitution." Some of you who are in my United States history class recognizes this as dovetailing with our discussion of the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, and the Bill of Rights. But, Jones continues, these cannot be repudiated without a political revolution. All political parties have upheld the Constitution and Declaration of Independence. When the Southern states repudiated the latter document by maintaining the doctrine of Negro slavery, it meant not a contest of politics, but a repudiation of the government itself. Political contests are settled every few years, quietly at the polls, but this question of liberty or slavery was settled by 4 years of terrible war. That's A.T. Jones in the American Sentinel, April 13, 1899. Jones also applied the issue of individual rights and anti-governance, which he was enamored, not only to the black plight in America, but to that of peoples of color worldwide. Listen to this. Quote, "The doctrine of self-government is right, absolutely and eternally right. If the Negro or the Filipino or the Cuban is a man, is it not to that extent a total destruction of self-government to say that he too shall not govern himself? When the white man governs himself, that is self-government. But when he governs himself, that is the black, the Filipino, or the Cuban, and also another man, that is more than self-government, that is despotism." Thoroughly Adventist at the time, Jones identified the popular derogatory entertainment of the day. And get this, because this is very interesting in my opinion. Thoroughly Adventist at the time, Jones identified the popular derogatory entertainment of the day, of which Christian churches had begun to engage in for monetary gain, as being a mark of Babylon. And you won't believe this. This is what Jones says about minstrelsy. You know what minstrelsy is? It's when either blacks or whites did it in blackface, and blacks, of course, you know, had watermelons, and all these characters are blacks playing a banjo, playing a fiddle, and hey, massa, I'll do what you want, massa, and jumping up and clicking their heels together. Listen to what Jones says about minstrelsy or blackface. Quote, "Not content with attending real Negro minstrel shows, it is that the society is in possession of a new fad in the form of Negro minstrel entertainments." This is when they were just becoming in vogue. "The queer part about it all is that the Negro minstrels are white persons with blackened faces. The popular church organizations such as the Epworth Leagues, Christian Endeavorers, King's Daughters, etc., have all fallen in with the prevailing spirit and are resorting to minstrel shows as a means to replenish their treasuries. It is further stated, and upon good authority, that society belles and the most aristocratic young men do not hesitate to blacken their faces and assume the characters of Negro performers on the amateur stage, because it is the thing to do so. And the songs that are sung either appeal to the senses or tend to arouse the sentiment of pathos through which evil is often wrought than is generally known. often are wrought than is generally known. Further, the results of this fad are even now coming to the front. And one city in an adjoining state, six fashionable young ladies, leaders in society, have fallen victims to the blandishment of a Negro who was secured to train them in the divine art of singing quote-unquote darky songs. Thus, the popular churches have discarded tithing, God's plan for filling the church treasury, and have abandoned the aid of the power of God, the Holy Spirit, are obliged to resort to carnal methods of raising money. A.T. Jones is talking about coonery. He's talking about minstrelsy. And this is how he ends it. Babylon is fallen. It's fallen. Come out of her, my people. That's the Advent Review in the Sabbath Herald, October 16, 1900. Above all, though, as editor of Seventh-day Adventist official organ, Advent Review and Sabbath Herald, from 1897 to 1901, A.T. Jones drew consistent attention to the cause of black civil rights by quoting at length icons like Booker T. Washington, of whom Seventh-day Adventist leadership was enamored, and who Jones opined that his doctrines of practical black uplift equally applied to whites and Seventh-day Adventists. And Abraham Lincoln, court cases such as Dred Scott versus Sanford, and incidents of cruel and unfair treatment toward blacks, of which Jones offered scathing editorial commentary. This blatantly pro-black civil rights newsprint comprised a significant portion of the fare of the broad Adventist readership of the Review during the critical Jones years. Adventists were reading what he was saying. Interestingly, Edson White, the white pioneer that did more for the black work than any other save his mother, got much of his enthusiasm for reaching blacks in the South from A.T. Jones during a ministerial institute in Atlanta in January 1894. Alonzo Jones, still meteoric since 1888, was delivering talks which Edson described as grand. He explained to his mother that his reason for going to Atlanta was first and foremost, quote, to get acquainted with the conditions in the South, the colored people, and see what opportunities there are for work among them. And second, to be schooled by Jones on what to expect when doing work in the South, both in present and in the future. In fact, even before this, what ignited Edson White in the first place to endeavor to reach blacks in the South was the 1888-inspired Battle Creek Revival of December 1892. Unfortunately, either Jones's 1880 glorification or notoriety, depending upon which Adventist camp is concerned, eclipses his work on race. Although his later partnership with Lewis Sheaf is cast primarily as being motivated by undermining the General Conference and Adventist leadership, the fact should not be dismissed that Jones never wavered, publicly of course, we don't know what happened in private, but he never wavered on the issue of segregation and black equality, and encouraged the free mixing of whites and blacks during a period when the SDA denomination and even Ellen White at times discouraged integration. Provocatively, as White and Jones drifted apart, White altered her position on the color line. Now, I have to say that this may have been completely coincidental. And of course, at that time, she was receiving letters from Edson who was saying, "Mother, even the perception in Mississippi that we are flouting the color line, even the perception is causing us to be violently persecuted." Of course, we know that Nate Olven, a black man, was taken from his house and whip tied, and his wife was actually shot in the leg by a posse, all because of just the perception that they were flouting the color line. But let's not miss the point. A.T. Jones, to this day, was a writer and political activist during the Jim Crow era whose sophistication on the race question has rarely been equaled, if ever, in the denomination. Next, we move to Ole Olson and black people. We said that Olson was sympathetic to the Jones-Wagner white contingent in 1888. And as a result, Ellen White, the ultimate Adventist kingmaker, arranged it, maneuvered it, that Ole Olson was elected General Conference President in 1888. A crucial aspect of Minneapolis is that it brought to the presidency a president interested in black people. Olson, stating rather belatedly at the General Conference on February 17, 1893, said this: "The time has also come when we should do something for the colored people of the South. There are more than 7 million of these people in the United States for whom we have virtually done nothing. We will recommend that the conference consider their claims upon us, and if thought best, make a department of that work, appointing someone to take the special oversight thereof with sufficient help to give it character and ensure success." Here, Ole Olson is suggesting a Negro department, which actually was instituted in 1909. He's suggesting it 16 years earlier. Yet it was in the final 2 years of his presidency, of Olson's presidency, that he actually took his advice and arguably did more in that amount of time for black Adventists than most white leaders before or since, by founding the Huntsville School, now Oakwood University, and overseeing its establishment. In fact, the case can be made that Olson was the primary founder of Oakwood, and his patronage for the institution serves as a puny but conspicuous atonement for the heretofore disinterest of Adventist leaders for the black world. Olson acted on the idea of a school in the South for blacks by personally traveling to Huntsville to assess possible locations with two of his top officers. As a leader, he stepped on the limb and riskily purchased the Beasley estate for the location of the black school using official church funds. He was a solid fundraiser on behalf of the fledgling institution. He played a key role in the selection of Oakwood leadership, and he continually put his name and influence behind the school, particularly in church periodicals, where he ran lengthy updates personally pinned on the school scores of times. It's Ole Olson. Curiously, after he left the General Conference in 1897, Olson took a post in South Africa and there specifically sought out blacks to evangelize, black Africans to evangelize. We're moving on to Ellen White. We want to talk about Ellen White, 1888, and black people. After Minneapolis in 1889 and 1890, Ellen White became deeply bothered over the church's neglect of blacks, for which they were doing scant little. On March 21, 1891, at the 1891 General Conference session in Battle Creek, during a time when blacks, thousands of blacks, tens of thousands of blacks in the South were being terrorized, and of course millions were living under the fear of terror, hung, lynched, jailed, raped, kept in illiteracy, and re-enslaved under the system of debt slavery. You know what debt slavery is? It's when a black man, usually, wanted to purchase food or housing or land in order to make a living and support and sustain his family. And he had to take out a loan to do it. But the loan had disproportionate interest attached to it. And when he took the loan, he couldn't even pay off the interest. And so he was jailed and often put in chain gangs and labor crews to just earn off the interest. And often this debt slavery, one man could be enslaved for 20 years. They were housed in cramped quarters, and diseases and all sorts of things were rampant in the debt peonage quarters. This is what would happen to blacks when Ellen White was giving the 1891 Our Duty of Colored People address. She delivered it to a select group of GC administrators. In this speech, she characterized the Adventist Southern involvement record during the post-Civil War years to that present day as sinfully neglectful. This is what she said: "Sin rests upon us as a church because we have not made greater effort for the salvation of souls among the colored people." This language is undeniably similar to the words she used for the rejection of the Christ our righteousness message of Jones and Wagner just two and eight, 9 months, years earlier. Over 2.5 years earlier. There are 5 overarching themes in this speech, each broad principles emanating from a newfound Christocentrism, courtesy of the 1888 session. Our duty to the colored people provides a durable link to Minneapolis by revealing a focused, yet durable and versatile Christology mandating a penetrating equality encompassing humanity with special regard to those who were denied it in the past. In this short talk, about 10 or 12 pages, Jesus is mentioned 21 times, Christ 36 times, Lord 14, Christian 8, and Savior 3. This speech marks the beginning of Ellen White's utilization of a lens first used in connection to the black situation in 1861, where she said, God gave him, that is the slave master, no title to human souls, and he has no right to hold them as property. Christ died for the whole human family, whether white or black. Here she's using Christology to rebuke slavery. It's condemned on a Christological basis. And nearly a quarter of a century after, in 1891, White again appeals to the denomination to evangelize blacks on the basis of Christology. Indeed, it seems that a contemplation of African Americans in Southern states reminded White especially of the earthly Christ. Listen to her opening words in the Our Duty to the Colored People address. There has been much perplexity as to how our laborers in the South shall deal with the color line. It has been a question to some how far to concede to the prevailing prejudice against the colored people. The Lord has given us light concerning all such matters. There are principles laid down in his word that should guide us in dealing with these perplexing questions. The Lord Jesus came to our world to save men and women of all nationalities. He died just as much for the colored people as for the white race. Jesus came to shed light over the whole world. At the beginning of his ministry, he declared his mission, and she quotes Isaiah 61:1. The Redeemer of the world was of humble parentage. He, the majesty of heaven, the King of glory, humbled himself to accept humanity, and then he chose a life of poverty and toil. For your sakes, he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. When one came saying, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest, Jesus answered him, the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man does not have anywhere to lay his head. He, the majesty of heaven, depended upon the generosity of his followers. Jesus did not seek the admiration or applause of the world. He commanded no army. He ruled no earthly kingdom. He passed by the wealthy and honored of the world. He did not associate with the leaders of the nation. He dwelt among the lowly of the earth. To all appearances, he was merely a humble man with few friends. Thus he sought to correct the world's false standard of judging the value of men. He showed that they are not to be estimated. They are not to be estimated by their outward appearance. Their moral worth is not determined by their worldly possessions, their real estate, or bank stock. It is the humble, contrite heart that God values. With him, there is no respecter of persons. The attributes that he prizes most are purity and love. And these are possessed only by the Christian. Jesus did not choose his disciples from the learned lawyers, the rulers, the scribes, the Pharisees. He passed them by because they felt whole, as many feel in this age, and prided themselves on their learning and position. They were fixed in their traditions and superstitions, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. He who could read all hearts chose poor fishermen who were willing to be taught. He gave them no promise of large salary or worldly honor, but told them that they should be partakers with him in his sufferings. Jesus, while in this world, ate with publicans and sinners and mingled with the common people, not to become low and earthly with them, but in order by precept and example to present to them right principles, to lift them up from their low habits and manners. And all this, he said, is an example that we should follow in his steps. That's the end of the quotation. Note the adjectives that Ellen White uses to describe Christ: poor, lowly, of humble parentage, and choosing to associate with poor fishermen, publicans, sinners, common people. This is comprehensive Christology. Adventists were to view blacks in the social strata as Jesus, to seek them out as Jesus sought out the socially unpromising, and to open their hearts to Christ to reproduce his incarnate behavior. Those who have a religious experience that opens their heart to Jesus will not cherish pride, but will feel that they are under obligation to God to be missionaries as was Jesus. They will seek and save that which was lost. The message of the incarnation of Christ was, for Ellen White, a message of identification with black people. You cannot accept Christ our righteousness while ignoring blacks. The two went hand in hand. And if one was indicted for the former, it had to, of necessity, be indicted for the latter, and vice versa. The broad Christological thematic categories predominating our duty are Christological salvation, Christological identification, Christological equality, Christological integration, and Christological missiology. To do nothing for blacks was to reject all things Christ. White's reckoning of the premise of the Seventh-day Adventist membership in relation to African Americans comprehended the most important Christian axioms, once again placing a race neglected in an essential role as challenger of the very core of the Adventist Christian profession. Indeed, Ellen White's most deeply practical Christian statements and ideas that are found in Our Duty to the Colored People originated from what she took from the controversial 1888 session, a renewed Christology characterized by a profound compassion for all of humanity, which manifested itself in seeking out the disadvantaged, relieving their suffering, and sharing with them the gospel. This is Christianity. There's nothing else. Ellen White's Christological explanation of the black plight in America cinches the connection. 1888 and 1891 would forever be joined by an uncomfortable and controversial confrontation with Christ. In 1888, through an acceptance of a doctrine that would yield a certain type of religious experience. In fact, 1888 is an experience, it's not a doctrine. And in 1891, through an identification with the people that would yield a missiological revolution. Ellen White continues in Our Duty. Quote, after my severe illness 1 year ago, many things which the Lord had presented to me seemed lost to my mind, but they have since been repeated. I know that which I now speak will bring me into conflict. This I do not covet, for the conflict has seemed to be continuous of late years. But I do not mean to live or die a coward, leaving my work undone. I must follow in my master's footsteps. It has become fashionable to look down upon the poor and upon the colored race in particular. But Jesus, the master, was poor, and he sympathizes with the poor, the discarded, the oppressed, and declares that every insult shown to them is shown to himself. I am more and more surprised as I see those who claim to be children of God possessing so little of the sympathy, tenderness, and love which actuated Christ. Would that every church, north and south, were imbued with the spirit of our Lord's teachings. As with the Christ Our Righteousness in 1888, White feared that her message on meeting blacks where they were would result in the same type of ostracism, division, and maltreatment that occurred in 1888. Provocatively, the same year of Our Duty, Ellen White was exiled down under to Australia. However, instead of desisting speaking about blacks, she ramped up her statements and never desisted until her death. And even then, She provided for blacks in clause 6 of her will. Now folks, that's the real deal. You can't sham that. You can't fake that. When you provide for black people in your will, that means you're the real deal. They say put your money where your mouth is. Clause number 6 in the will. It is my belief that the twin messages of 1888 and 1891, Christ our righteousness and black evangelism, were the defining messages of Ellen White's senior citizen years. And the messages, 1888 and 1891, were one and the same. But if 1888 Minneapolis was a denial of the message of faith in the righteousness of Christ, then 1891 was a rejection of the message of imitation of the example of Christ. Adventism's preoccupation with doctrine is on full display in the perpetual debate over the meaning and rejection of 1888 amidst a total disregard for the rejection of the pointedly pragmatic and functional message of 1891. The now vexed idea of corporate sin resting on the Seventh-day Adventist body until such time as they fulfill their sacred duty of helping the black race runs throughout our duty, and indeed is the thrust of the message. From this point on, nearly every time Ellen White communicated about blacks, it was in the context of aiding them, helping them, assisting them. The guilt on the church for neglecting this responsibility was most likely a holdover from 1888 corporate guilt speak. Two interesting dynamics emerge here. First, Adventists accepting the Minneapolis message, whose distinct Christology permeates our duty, would have prepared them to properly labor for blacks, focused and free of the limiting prejudice. Second, and premised upon the first, the rejection of the 1888 message was necessarily the rejection of the our duty message. Indeed, in over 800 pages of writing about blacks, Ellen White chides the denomination countless times for the rejection of Christ in the person of black people, stating flatly that the church could never be right with God until it went to aid the suffering blacks. The church would be speechless in the final judgment because of its neglect of the least of these. You recall Matthew 25. This eschatological threat from White, culminating in an eventual bankruptcy of trust in the General Conference. She admitted that the General Conference was no longer the voice of God after years of them siphoning and misappropriating funds earmarked for the black work. White's view of Adventism here is instructive, for church historians and authors have rarely evaluated the Seventh-day Adventist denomination based on race. Indeed, the standing of the church has been judged by doctrinal correctness, educational excellence, medical innovation, and fiscal solvency, but almost never on how the members treat other human beings made in the image of Christ and oppressed ones at that. Historiographically, the archetypal choice between 1888 and 1891, that is doctrinal and experiential alignment as opposed to humanitarianism, always seems to go to 1888, with no thought that the two are inseparably intertwined as is seen in the pragmatic Christology of our duty. If White was to evaluate the church in the 21st century, 2011, based on race relations, would it survive a probing and intrusive scrutiny? Our duty to the colored people is a sophisticated late 19th century antecedent of the What Would Jesus Do movement in mainstream Christianity, albeit with much more at stake than modern frivolous suburban scenarios might pose. It is my position that Ellen White's concomitant push for black evangelism in the South was fueled by this revivalist spirit dominating Adventism in the 1890s. Indeed, her statements on the urgency of black missions can only be fully grasped in the context of the swell of 1888 revivalism. White, along with Jones and Prescott, was the key proponent of an imminent loud cry and hurried parousia, hurried Second Advent, resulting from the 1888 teachings and the resulting experience in the hearts of believers. White's emphasis on the millions of African Americans in the southern United States should be seen as a long-awaited forerealization of black eschatological importance, an Adventist revival apocalyptic thinking that was absent in the 1840s when it was believed that the Advent could have occurred while blacks were still enslaved and unwarned. And I feel very strongly about this. Everyone talks about 1844 and Millerism and the Great Disappointment, but the millions of blacks enslaved in the South are never thought of. How could Jesus have come without his people, African Americans, being warned? In fact, it seemed like the only pioneer that had any clue about this was Joseph Bates. And he actually tried to penetrate the slave South. He started in Eastern Shore, Maryland. And that's about as far as he got. This is during the Millerite years, 1842. This argument may be extended further and serve as a possible but partial answer to the unremarkable question as to why Ellen White suddenly became so focused on blacks in 1891 and not closer to their emancipation in 1865. This revival spirit, combined with the previously touched on international missions, matured White's worldview in ways that the teenage visionary in the 1840s and 1850s could not have grasped. The world and vast others of the loud cry would enable Seventh-day Adventists to reach with the gospel was now not the faceless and foreign of faraway climes, but the very real African Americans just below the Mason-Dixon line. This embeds the Minneapolis watershed, called by one prominent church historian as quote unquote one of the great Adventist turning points and a revolution that we have never completed, deeply in black Seventh-day Adventist history, a connection that has not yet even been hinted at. But 1888 should be repositioned as pivotal in the history of not only black Americans, but the international Adventism in general. For after Minneapolis, all of the leading figures involved in the conference left the United States and took the message internationally. I want to bring this all to our present day and present as best I can as an impartial historian without taking sides. In this last part of my talk, I will just lightly touch on how the modern debate over 1888 and Righteous by Faith came about and its link to black people. Ellen White's deeply Christian appeals in Our Duty eloquently speak to a thorny problem that has dogged Seventh-day Adventism for more than half a decade. That of not being considered Christian by evangelical Protestants because of the doctrine of the investigative judgment, which seemed, according to them, and I don't know how in the world you can come up with this, but it seemed, according to them, to diminish the central Christian tenet of the death of Jesus on the cross as a complete salvific act and promoted what many considered to be a preoccupation with human performance. In 1957, important Adventist theologians published Questions on Doctrine, an apologetic volume intended to present Adventists as Christian to the Protestant world. Look, we're Christian. We're Christian. Questions wasn't too effective, for several years later, Walter Martin labeled Seventh-day Adventists as a cult in The Truth About Seventh-day Adventism, produced in 1960, and his landmark book, The Kingdom of the Cults, produced in 65. In response, Adventists launched an unprecedented media and public relations blitz, and Martin removed the church in subsequent editions of The Kingdom. But the damage was done, with greater numbers of evangelicals considering Adventism unchristian and a cult, and a division in Adventism over what some saw as a compromising and detrimental doctrinal shift to become Christian, and a sycophantic pandering to Babylon. Curiously, much of the ensuing heated debates and fractioning revolved around the 1888 message, what it truly consisted of, and whether or not the church had rejected it. The sequelae was the emergence of liberal and conservative or historic Adventists polarizing and militating on both sides of the issue. One historian summarizes that the publication of Questions on Doctrine and the events surrounding it did more than any other single event in Adventist history to create what appear to be permanently warring factions within the denomination. Most provocatively, for our interests here, The resuscitation of the debate over the legacy and meaning of 1888. Get this. The resuscitation, the resurrection of the debate over the legacy and meaning of 1888, emerging from the Adventist evangelical debates within Seventh-day Adventism, was occasioned by black missions. I want you to listen to this with 1888 and 1899, the link between those 2 years, as a backdrop while you're listening to what I'm saying. The resuscitation of the debate over the legacy and meaning of 1888, emerging from the Adventist evangelical debates within Seventh-day Adventism, was occasioned by black missions. East African missionary for a quarter of a century, Robert J. Wieland, of the Wieland and Short fame, the individual responsible more than anyone else for rehabilitating 1888 and Adventism, called for corporate denominational repentance at the 1950 General Conference session in San Francisco for rejecting the 1888 message in a letter from Africa. Wieland admitted that he first discovered the efficacy of H. Jones' teaching when he taught them to Ugandans and saw their lives transformed. Listen to this unbelievable excerpt from Dennis Hakama, his article, Out of Africa, 1888 Reexamined, turns 50. Listen to this. Robert J. Wieland was at first very depressed and disillusioned when he got to Africa because of rampant sexual promiscuity by native workers and the constant lying that took place to conceal it. Many of the church school teachers were sleeping with their students. It was completely out of control, and he was encouraged by some experienced missionaries to just accept it as part of their culture. But he could not accept that. Then he found a solution to the problem in the chapters of Glad Tidings that he had brought with him. The book Glad Tidings, a compilation by Jones. He discovered that the 1888 Righteous by Faith included an understanding of the nature of Christ, which was completely human, including sexuality. That meant that Christ had to conquer sexual desire also. Since Christ was empowered to conquer sexual desire and was our Savior, it implied that the Holy Spirit would also empower believers to control sexual passions also. This was at first a shocking idea to the natives, but it also made Christ someone they could now identify with. Wieland concluded that the 1888 theological package containing Glad Tidings was the key to the Adventist message and built his ministry around that. This included a non-dispensational unified understanding of the covenants, the complete humanness of Christ, which made him our example in every way, and the unconditional gift of salvation to every human at the cross. The objective gift being irrespective of works on man's part. Wieland maintained from his response the Adventist denomination as a body needed to replicate the African reception. From Wieland's appeals and subsequent prolific activity, the debate over 1888 has lasted for well over a decade and continues to this day. And so amazingly, the modern 1888 debate originated with black missiology in Africa. I want to close this presentation with a vision Ellen White related on February 23, 1899, in which she seamlessly joins Jesus Christ and blacks where they should be. Quote, I have been deeply stirred during the night season. I have been deeply stirred during the night season. I was in a meeting where were present men to whom had been entrusted large responsibilities. I cannot now write as fully as I would like to because I have not the strength, but I have words to say that I dare not leave unsaid. One stood in our midst. Capital O, and said, there is a large work to be done, and lines that the Lord has laid out before you, a work that has yet scarcely been touched. I have sent messages to you. And what have you done for the southern field, for the colored people? What have you done with the means solicited for that field? You have robbed this destitute field of the means that God designed should come to it. Sounds like Malachi 3, doesn't it? The money brought in response to the appeals made in behalf of the southern field was just as much set apart for that work as is the tithe for the support of the ministers. Mismanagement, wrong methods, ill-advised movements have brought a reproach upon the work and cause of God, and these matters need to be adjusted. The bookwork needs to be cleansed of every artful intrigue. Those who have stood at the head of his unjust dealing, will never be clean in the sight of God until they restore that which they have taken away. They are held responsible for the work that might have been done, but is not. The use of means and lines that will make a good showing is right, but not until you have done the work the Lord has appointed you to do in the field that has been so manifestly neglected. The Lord says, their suffering, their poverty, their degradation has come up before me. I have heard their cries. I have seen their neglect. I have called your attention to the field, but the means you should have used to advance the work there, you have appropriated to more pleasing work, to more promising fields. Fields that have not such necessities and will reveal no better results. There need be no dearth of means today for the advancement of the work. This is Jesus speaking, folks. But the Lord has no pleasure in his people because pride and selfishness have expelled mercy and the love of God and for their fellow men from their hearts. Wrong actions are clothed with the pretense of righteousness. That which the Lord calls dissembling, false weights, unjust balances, and fraud. There have been dishonesty, fraud, the turning away of man from his rights and disregarding the principles and commandments of God. You have had men, schemes, and devising of plans with the idea that you could, as a board, have power to do anything that would serve the conference and bring in a revenue. But it was more grievous in the sight of God because you there were covering the dishonest practices, saying, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are we. Yes, but that temple was just as much in need of cleansing as the temple courts in the days when Christ was upon earth. The Lord hates the mixture he saw in the earthly temple. Unholy bartering in the temple courts brought forth the righteous indignation of an insulted God. Wrong actions are clothed with the pretense of righteousness and fraud. This is the iniquity of the people of God. They have not restored the pledge or brought back that which they have taken away. Truth hath fallen in the street, and iniquity cannot enter. The deepest humility should be felt by those who have had the privilege of enlightenment and education in missionary lines. The Lord God of heaven, by whom all actions are weighed in the golden balance of the sanctuary, looks upon the thousands of colored people, our neighbors, who in their destitution are spreading their cases before the giver of all mercy and blessings. These people are perishing in their sins. It's Jesus talking to Ellen White in vision. These people are perishing in their sins. As a people, they are ignorant, many knowing nothing of purity and godliness and elevation. But among them are men and women of quick perceptions, excellent talents, and these will be revealed when once the Spirit of God shall turn their attention to the Word. Thank you.